Good evening to you all, and I'm delighted to be asked by my sister Phil to introduce her to you tonight. By way of introduction, I will share with you something of our background as a family, because it's quite pertinent to the journey. Our parents were Irish immigrants who came to the Midlands of England to work during the Second World War. We're an Irish Catholic family of nine children, five girls and four boys. I am the third child, and Phil is the fourth. You all call her Philo, but in the family we call her Phil, so we are talking about the same person. Phil, unbeknown to us, came across Baha'is when she attended a small Catholic college, which was part of Birmingham University, when she was around the age of 20. And after a year teaching in France as part of her uni course, she returned as a Baha'i. I remember our mum saying, and you have to hear this in an Irish accent, which I won't insult Irish friends by trying to do. I remember distinctly her saying, "You send your child to a Catholic college and she comes back a Baha'i." Our parents were a little upset. Their generation did not often change from Catholicism. And of course, they were worried as well. For one thing, it was an unfamiliar Eastern name. Over time, as they met many kindly Baha'i friends from the larger Birmingham community, they realised that even if they didn't understand everything about the Baha'i faith, they recognised that it was a force for good in the world. They met many Iranian friends, and it was around this time that we often commented on the similarities between Iranian and Irish culture, not least the hospitality and the sense of humour. After a year of teaching in France, Phil then announced that she was going to Mexico. It's what Baha'is now would call a year of service pioneering, which became three. She went on to work on Baha'i projects in Belize, Central America, whilst working for an airline company, Air Florida. To be honest, as a family, we didn't really have a clue what she was up to. They were very different times. She missed my wedding and several other significant family events, and we've only just about forgiven her for doing so. And here we are. Unexpectedly for all of us, the sudden emergence of Zoom, able to attend Baha'i Firesides, and there's quite a few different members of the family here tonight and others who will catch up on YouTube. While I have remained a lifelong, very active Catholic, the Firesides have deepened my understanding of the Baha'i faith, which has been the driving force in my sister Phil's life. Phil will be exploring this evening the extraordinary life of Martha Root, one of the first Baha'is of the West during the early 1900s. Her story reads like an adventure and affirms the observation that history well written is interesting and fascinating as fiction is. It is so full and so rich, it cannot be contained in one session. So Phil will continue next week. She's always talked too much, so you'll get to see that. You get to see that tonight. Martha circled the globe four times in her ardent desire to convey the beauty of the Baha'i faith with its timeless message of international peace and unity. This is a story which should inspire us all to believe that anything is possible. So sit back and enjoy the journey. Thanks, Phil.
Thank you, Bernie. Thank you. Wonderful introduction. Thank you so much. And it's lovely to be here. I have to say that my story in doing this story was quite a story. It began with just quite a small workshop at the Welsh Summer School. Those of you who have not come across the Baha'i Faith, pre the pandemic, we would hold summer, winter schools each year. And I offered this as like a small workshop at the Welsh Summer School a year ago, exactly. And from that, a few of the friends couldn't attend the session. So I then offered it to a few communities. And earlier on this year, in March, actually, I was up in London, ready to offer this story to the London community. And that was when the pandemic broke. I was also, interestingly enough, Philip and Esmir Kuhman very kindly organised for me to do this talk in Oxford. And now we are in Oxford. Exactly 8-9 months ago, I would say. And so here we are now. At the time, the Bella Owen, who organised the London workshop, she asked if I could present it on Skype. And I said, no, absolutely impossible. You can't tell a story on Skype. And here we are, 8-9 months later, we're not only telling stories, we're having meetings and musical events, all kinds of things on Skype. So it's very interesting how the world has changed. And as Bernie said, this is about Martha Root, an extraordinary woman, or as I like to say, an ordinary person who achieves the extraordinary. And I think that's typical of all of us. We are all capable of this. And she did indeed circle the globe 4 times. And I've been thinking of her as I was preparing for this talk on Zoom. And I thought, what would she make of it? Here we are now, we're all in one room together. And when we get chatting later, we will see that there are people here literally from all over the world. I think she might be slightly annoyed as well, because the trouble she went through to get to the places that she got to was just extraordinary. So yes, different times really. So I'll just try to share my screen. Okay, so here we are, Martha Root. Martha was born in Cambridge Springs, Ohio, Pennsylvania in 1872. Nothing out of the ordinary with her childhood. She was, at 14 years old, she won a writing competition. She was a good writer, and perhaps indicative of her future life was that she got a monetary prize for this competition. And unlike her peers, who would have perhaps chosen to buy a new dress or something like that, she opted to go and visit Niagara Falls. So I think this was a portent for the future. She moved on. She was from a simple farming community, a small farm. Again, nothing out of the ordinary. She was a Christian lady from a Baptist Christian background, and her father was a deacon in the church. So a committed Christian, from an early age. The differences began to show by the time she reached the age of 17, because typical of girls of her age in the early 1900s, she would then have finished her education. But this was not enough for Martha. She wanted to carry on. And she not only wanted to carry on, she did not wish to go to her local college because she just thought it wasn't good enough. So she absolutely begged her father to let her go to Oberlin College, which meant staying away from home, which absolutely wasn't typical of the time. He agreed to go, to let her go, and she did go there. She studied languages. She wanted to be able to speak in public. She took Latin, she took French, many foreign languages, and she stayed there for 5 years. So when she finished there in 1894, she then went on to Chicago, which again meant living away from home. absolutely not typical of the time, where she finally got her baccalaureate degree in 1895. And when she came out with her degree, again, typical of young women at the time, if they had any education, she became a school teacher, and she did this for a couple of years. But by now, Martha's drive and ambition were beginning to show. And with this talk, I'd like us all, I really want to go into Martha Root's drive, her ambition, her spiritual life in depth, and for us all to think what motivated her, what drove her. I think most of us who are Baha'is have heard of Martha Root, and often we know chronologically some of the things that she achieved, but I would like to look at it in, you know, a little bit more depth, really. So she leaves the school, she moves to Pittsburgh, and here's a bit grainy, sorry, it's not the best quality. It's a picture of downtown Pittsburgh. You can just about make out tram cars and the motor car alongside horses and buggies. Industry was absolutely taking off at this time in the early 1900s. You've probably heard of Andrew Carnegie, a well-known, he made a gargantuan fortune, and he became a well-known philanthropist at the end of his life. Heinz Baked Beans started their life here, and if you grew up on Heinz Baked Beans like we did, that's where they started, in Pittsburgh. So it was a very sort of exciting time. You know, people were moving in the countryside where Martha was from. People were still going around with horses and buggies, but in Pittsburgh, industry was really taking off. So here Martha began her newspaper career. She started with the Index of Pittsburgh Life, was her first job. It was the Pittsburgh Chronicle actually, and she became society editor. She was a young woman in her mid-20s, and she walked straight into this job, and she managed it. Now, considering the spiritual journey that she went on later on in her life, she was not at all on that journey at this particular time. She was actually writing articles about the rich, the super rich. She was going into their homes, a bit like Hello Magazine, I guess, you know, all the society pages that we see in the Sunday newspapers. So that was the kind of world that she moved in. But perhaps just to get an idea of what she, I mean, we saw a photograph of her. She was not tall. She was small, maybe perhaps 5'3" tall, quietly spoken, brown, light brown hair. There was nothing extraordinary about her, but she just moved in these kind of, you know, these sort of society circles just through her journalist career. So she was always moving forward. She did that for a while, and obviously the rich and famous were amongst the first people to get hold of a motor car. Now Martha was entranced by the motor car, and she managed to persuade her newspaper that they should have an automobile section, and not only should they have an automobile section, but that she should run it. So that's what she did. And she was quite happy in Pittsburgh, but she really had this ambition to travel. So she wanted to go to Paris, because the cars in the US at the time were getting to around 10, 15 miles an hour, where she'd heard that in Paris they were reaching speeds of up to 50 miles an hour. So she persuaded her editor to let her go. She offers to do some marketing articles for the ship so that she gets her ticket paid for on the boat. I mean, remember Martha, she wasn't from a poor family, but she certainly wasn't from a wealthy family, and she had to earn her living. So off they go to Paris to cover one of the first speed races from Paris to Versailles. It was actually in, and this will mean something to people who know about cars, not me, I'm afraid, the Berg automobile. That was the one. Mr. Berg, Hart Oberg, was an American, but he was developing these cars in Europe and then transporting them back to America. So there she was in Versailles. She'd gone over on the boat. Now, something indicative of her future life happened in Paris. She booked into a hotel alongside other colleagues, but she only stayed there for one night. She was very keen to get out and live amongst French people. She didn't want to stay in a hotel with her fellow Americans. So the next day she went out and booked herself into a boarding place where French was spoken. So she always had this desire to improve herself and to push herself forward. So in Paris, she not only covers the speed race, she gets a ride in the car, and she describes it thus. I'm going to read it from the book. This car, it didn't have a front window. She described stopping for gasoline, its cost, the route to Versailles, where the cars would go at a pretty fast rate. This time, the wind faced us, and as the car lunged down the long grade with full speed gear in and accelerated to the utmost, my only sensation was that I was being compressed in air, then in ice. I remember seeing nothing but a streak of air in the vista ahead. The magic 50 miles an hour was reached. Martha had experienced the future. She closed the article with a superb technical description of the Berg creation that he was taking back to America with him. And this is quite important, sorry, just gone forward there. But Martha, in her column, she wouldn't just describe the beauty of the cars. She was very interested in the technical side and how it all worked. So that was that. She went back to Pittsburgh, and as part of her brief now, she also was covering religious matters. And in 1908, Martha attended an interdenominational missionary convention held in Pittsburgh. She was covering it for the newspaper. Soon after the conference, Martha and some colleagues went down to Pittsburgh, and that they entered Child's Restaurant. The conference was over and they were just having something to eat in there. It was packed, actually, when they went in. With her colleagues, they were discussing the conference. And basically, now this would have been an interdenominational Christian conference, not the kind of interfaith thing that we're used to today, where we have, you know, people from actual different faiths, you know, Hinduism, Buddhism, whatever. This would have been probably Catholic, Baptist, Methodist, that sort of thing. So they were discussing this. In walks a gentleman called Roy Wilhelm. Now, Roy Wilhelm was a coffee broker. He was from a fairly wealthy family, and he was a Baha'i. He was one of the handful of early Baha'is in America at this time. He had actually just been out to the Holy Land to visit Abdul Baha. Now, Abdul Baha was the son of Baha'u'llah, the founder of the Baha'i Faith. We've had stories on Abdul Baha at previous Firesides here. And Roy had just been out to the Holy Land, to Haifa, in northern Palestine, to visit Abdul Baha, kind of on a pilgrimage, really. He had just returned and he needed to get something to eat. And of course, it was in the days before fast food. You couldn't go and buy a sandwich somewhere. There was nothing at his hotel. So he went down to Pittsburgh and looked into Child's Restaurant. Now, there were no spaces, but he waited for a little while and the waiter found one table, one space next door to where Martha Root and her colleagues were sitting. So in he goes and he sits down. Now, I guess some of you, like me, have had the experience of sitting in a restaurant by yourself when you're traveling, you just can't help but overhear the conversation in the on the next table. So Roy was like that. He wasn't eavesdropping. He just, you know, was overhearing the conversation. And when they were discussing the interdenominational conference, they were basically saying it will never work. It's impossible. They just, you know, it just won't happen. And he resisted at first, but eventually, as they got up to leave, he sort of introduced himself and he said, I'm sorry, I couldn't help but overhear your conversation, but I have actually just been out to Haifa and I'm now part of a religion which actually promotes and or, you know, believes in the unity of all religions, all faiths, that we're all brothers and sisters of the same human family. Now, nobody else in the group particularly picked up on what Roy was saying, but Martha did. For some reason, she just picked up on what he was saying. Don't forget, she was a journalist, an astute journalist, and it just kind of interested her. So they exchanged cards. And that was it, really. You know, they just exchanged cards. Now, after that, Roy sent her a book. Martha did not, she wasn't immediately interested in the Baha'i faith at all. You know, she had, the story actually goes that the book that Roy had sent her, it probably had names on like Abdul Baha or Baha'u'llah, quite Eastern sounding names. And that Martha actually felt vaguely embarrassed walking around with this book. And apparently she was in a drugstore and she kind of accidentally on purpose left the book on the counter and walked out. Now, the story goes that the drugstore's owner's wife picked the book up, read it, and actually became a Baha'i. She also knew Martha and she was able to track her down and get the book back to her. Now, eventually, Martha starts to meet up with Roy to discuss the Baha'i faith. Not only Roy, some of the early Baha'is in America. Here's a couple of them. Lewis Gregory we saw a few weeks ago because Terence did a beautiful presentation on him. He was one of the first Black Baha'is in America. And Thornton Chase. Lua Getzinger was another one of the early Baha'is of the US. She was an actress, actually, an actor, to start off with, at least. Now, neither of these people met Martha at the beginning, but Thornton Chase did. He was in Chicago. And basically, the early Baha'is, what they would do is they would go and meet in a restaurant, in a cafe, like we all used to pre-pandemic. And they would, like, sit for an hour. And she would go up there and talk about, just find out as much as she could about the Baha'i faith. Don't forget, she was a journalist and she was nobody's fool, if I can say it like that. She was really looking into this thing in depth. She just didn't want to accept something without knowing about it, without really researching it. And I also wondered whether, because she was an investigative journalist, whether she'd actually looked into any of the writings from Lord Curzon in Britain. He had written letters to the Times. He travelled extensively in Persia. He wrote a book called Persia and the Persian Question, which I've given to my nephew. I used to own it. And he certainly wrote to the London Times about the persecution of the very early Baha'is, which we also heard about a few weeks ago on this fireside. She may have looked into that. She may have looked into the fact that Tolstoy had written very favourably about the inception of this new faith, or indeed Edward Granville Brown from Cambridge University, an Orientalist who had travelled in the East extensively, and he actually was the first Westerner to meet Baha'u'llah. I don't know, but I think she may have done because she was a journalist and she wanted to find out everything that she needed to know about this new faith. So eventually Martha does indeed, you know, become a Baha'i. And as she was a journalist, she felt that she should write an article in her newspaper about the Baha'i Faith and what prompted her to accept it. And I think it's worth stopping here just for a couple of minutes and looking into Martha's article that she wrote in the Pittsburgh Post, her newspaper, on the 26th of September 1909. It's important because we need to know, what did the Baha'i message hold that stopped Martha Louise Root in mid-career and caused her to change course? What were the pathways that opened Martha's mind? So in her newspaper article, which I'm sure is on the internet somewhere, she quotes Baha'u'llah in saying that we desire but the good of the world and the happiness of the nations, that all nations should become one in faith, all men as brothers, that the bonds of affection and unity between all men should be strengthened. She noted as well that the Baha'i revelation recognized every earlier religion as equally divine in origin, if you like, all raised from the same sun. And again, if I can just explain what Martha tried to say on this. When she was in the restaurant in Chicago with the early Baha'is, they obviously didn't have the internet and, you know, access to digital images, but I'm pretty sure they would have, between them, they would have got a pen and paper and they would have drawn a diagram like this to explain the Baha'i concept on progressive revelation, that there is only one God who may be described as omniscient, omnipresent, you know, in any holy book, you'll get this kind of description of God. We can liken God to the sun, if you like, and the rays of the sun, which shine down upon humanity, are the spiritual teachers from time immemorial. But the ones that we know about are like Abraham, Krishna, Moses, Zoroaster, Buddha, Christ, of course, Muhammad, the Bab, and Baha'u'llah. So in this, what Martha liked about the Baha'i revelation was that this acceptance of all the past religions gone by, and that love, if you like, love is eternal in the past and eternal in the future. That's an eternal thread that runs throughout all the faiths. And that's, Abdu'l-Bahá spoke very much about this when he comes on the scene later. The thing that changes are the social laws. For example, in Judaism, very early on, there would be a law of an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. We see this in the Old Testament, but I'm sure that, you know, I belong, you know, to a quite active interfaith group in Cornwall, and we often discuss things. You know, any modern Jew would tell you that, you know, that law is no longer relevant for the modern day, or they would interpret it symbolically or in some other way. It's those kind of laws might change according to the time, and or the outlook or the message might change, but love is eternal between all of these. But what interested me was that Martha didn't, why was she following a route of faith? Because this was the time of the rational mind, people were more inclined to follow atheism. And in fact, that has been the pattern, you know, up to the present day. We live in a very secular society, in the West at least, you know, with the onset of industrialization and all the rest of it. But this was not Martha's way. She was a committed Christian. What was very important to Martha, and in fact, in her article at the end, she puts in some frequently asked questions, like, do Baha'is believe in Jesus Christ? And she answers it herself and says, well, yes, of course, you know, Christ was a messenger from God. And she writes about Baha'u'llah's social teachings in particular, which are relevant for today. Teachings of universal peace, a spiritual solution to the economic problem, the elimination of extremes of wealth and poverty, of course, the equality between men and women, all of these kind of things. So she wrote an extensive article in her in her newspaper, she pointed to the fact that it wouldn't only be people of religion. Baha'u'llah had mentioned this in the future, that, you know, when the sun comes, it shines on everybody. You know, it's not a club that it's only going to shine on a few. When it rains on everybody too, as we see with the current pandemic. And that, you know, lots of social good has come with these divine teachers, and that much of what happens in the world is performed by people who don't have any particular faith, humanists or whatever. And this, of course, is all for the good. So Martha, this was Martha's point of view. So I thought it was worth just stopping there for a few minutes. I hope I'm going to get enough time to talk about all her travels now. But I think we need to understand what it was that made her so change course in life. So now, the next significant thing to happen was Abdul Baha, the son of Baha'u'llah, who, if you remember, Roy Wilhelm had been out to visit him. He now manages to visit America. Now, Abdul Baha, the son of Baha'u'llah, when I do the talk next week, I'll show you the journey that they all went on. This religion began in Iran, but basically they were banished from Iran. I'll explain that next week. I won't take time on it now. But Abdul Baha had spent his life either in prison or being banished. He had a life of complete hardship until 1908. They were still imprisoned in Akka. She mentioned that with each new religion, the adherents early on are persecuted. And indeed, with the Baha'i Faith, there were 20,000 at least of the early adherents who were martyred and killed. They tried to do the same with Abdul Baha and the Holy Family, but, you know, they did survive, thankfully, so that he was able to come to the West. But she said, this was all in her newspaper article, in spite of these persecutions, the faith does not die. It doesn't go away in the same way that Christianity is the most widespread religion in the world today. And it started with a few disciples and intense persecution, but it hasn't gone away. And Martha describes this as being typical of religions that are here to endure, and that you will know them by their fruits. You know, she quotes Christ on that. So Abdul Baha comes to America. These are a couple of Abdul Baha's quotes, uplifting quotes. And of course, Martha, like all the early Baha'is, was very keen to meet up with him. And she does get a couple of private interviews with Abdul Baha, of course, because she's a journalist. She's following his journeys as well, and she's publishing them in the newspaper. Now, the significant thing that happened with Martha's meeting with Abdul Baha, she's now approaching 40 years old. And she has discovered or been diagnosed with breast cancer. And she tells Abdul Baha about this. Now, Abdul Baha was not, you know, there are stories of Abdul Baha, you know, sort of healing, that sort of thing, you know, but Abdul Baha would advise anybody to go and see a doctor, to go and see a physician. And indeed, when he was back in Haifa, he worked with the poor. He was a very simple person himself. He only possessed one coat. And he was always employing a doctor to go and see the poor, to help them. But he knew Martha would not go and see a doctor. She just didn't want to. He prescribed some sort of homeopathic remedy for her. And, you know, that was it, really. But it's just important to remember this, that she's had this diagnosis. I'm not a medical person. I think those physicians, those doctors who are, I know there's a few, my daughter and her husband and brother-in-law here tonight, and Kay and other people who are all medical doctors. And I don't know what the treatment was for cancer in 1912. Breast cancer has a good prognosis now, but I think back then, I don't know what the prognosis was, or, you know, what would have happened. But perhaps we can discuss that, you know, in question time. Okay, so Martha also, by this time, and we need to look at what, we've looked at what has motivated her regarding the Baha'i Faith. She's taken it on board. She loves the message of universal peace and unity, and she wants to share this with the world. So she tells this to Abdu'l-Bahá, that she would like to start traveling, you know, to travel and to help to pass the Baha'i message around the world. Now, this will seem quite strange to the Baha'is who are here, because Abdu'l-Bahá was not that keen on Martha traveling. It will seem strange because after this, from about 1916 to 17, Abdu'l-Bahá encouraged the Baha'is to leave America, to go and go across the world and take this message of universal peace with them, which they did. And they did a pretty good job on it, because, you know, the Baha'i Faith is now known, it's not the largest numerically, but it is the most, after Christianity, it's the most widespread geographically. You know, you'll find the Baha'i Faith in every location, island, you know, in the world, really. But he didn't actually want Martha to go. And we're not sure why. It was perhaps because she was a woman, she was vulnerable. In those days, we have to remember, this is 1912 we're talking about. It wasn't usual for women to travel alone. But Abdu'l-Bahá was a great proponent of the equality of men and women. And the Baha'i ethos is that if you have two children, a boy and a girl, if you've only got money to educate one, you should educate the girl first, being the mother of the child. So it wasn't that, you know, he didn't think she wasn't capable. Perhaps he worried about her. He also worried about how she would survive financially, because obviously she had a good job. She was an editor of a society magazine, newspaper, and she had a good future ahead of her, which, you know, what would happen to all of that if she started traveling? But anyway, he thought that would be fine for her to start traveling. That they discussed it, and she did. So moving on, Martha's first journey. Her first journey. Now, what she really wanted to do, because after Abdu'l-Bahá had gone back to Haifa in the Holy Land, he went back in 1913, and Martha was very keen to get to the Holy Land and to go on pilgrimage, basically, to visit the holy places there, and of course to visit Abdu'l-Bahá. That was her main aim in traveling, but she'd also got, you know, another agenda. So off she goes, the 13th of March, 1915. She arrives in Egypt, and this is a picture of Martha with a group of young Egyptian student Baha'is. And you see many, many pictures like this of Martha, always dressed in white. She would deliver talks. This was just the beginning, really. She would deliver as many talks as she could, and she always dressed in white. This was her way. So these are the first Baha'is that she's met outside of America. But while she was in Egypt, she was terribly disappointed because she found that she was unable to go to the Holy Land. I did a talk before on Wealthy Tudor Pole and Abdu'l-Bahá. And of course, the First World War was waging at this time. It was terribly dangerous. There was no way that she could go. And Abdu'l-Bahá dissuaded her from trying to come. It would have been far too dangerous for her to do that. Actually, sadly, she was in Egypt for 6 weeks. I think there was a lull in the, you know, the war or the activities in the Holy Land. And Abdu'l-Bahá did cable her to come, but sadly she missed getting that cable. So basically she then sailed on to Mumbai, Bombay as it was known at the time. She went down to India, having missed Abdu'l-Bahá's letters. She visited the friends there. I think this first trip was a little bit more of a fact-finding trip. She visited the Baha'i friends, she gave talks, she spoke intensely. There's quite a nice description, actually, if I can just find it in the book, from her interpreter, who was a young student actually in Bombay at the time, and he describes Miss Root as, he didn't think she really required a translator. He said, as soon as people saw her, they would concentrate respectfully on her. And if ever I spoke, I was ignored. Heart spoke to heart, and there was no need of translation. I had never before witnessed such spiritual communion. So that's quite interesting that he felt that she was just able to commune with people on this deep spiritual level. After this, Martha then travels to Burma. Now, her trip to Burma was quite interesting, if I show you in the next slide. In these days, when you traveled, there were very few hotels, they were just starting, there were no Airbnb, there was, you know, nowhere to stay really. So when she gets to Burma and she approaches the friends there, they're not sure where she should stay, but the wealthiest individual in Mandalay had a harem, and he suggested that she would be most comfortable there. And Martha takes advantage, and you can't read the print of this, of course, but what she was doing while she was traveling, she was still writing articles for the newspaper back home. She was still kind of employed by them still. And she would send these kind of articles back home. New York girl spends 10 days in a harem. So that was where she stayed. And of course, they were very fun articles, and the newspapers in America just loved them. And I think it gives you a sense of her, you know, she was a deeply spiritual person, but she had a great sense of fun as well. One didn't preclude the other. Now, Martha found her way to the Baha'i Center in Burma. Here's a picture of her. There she is in the center. Now, Burma in 1915 had a thriving, very large Baha'i community. Martha loved it there. She absolutely loved it. Up until now, she'd just met individual Baha'is in America. She hadn't really seen what the Baha'i way of life is. But in Burma, she did. In the Baha'i Center, they took in orphans. They looked after the elderly. They would teach the Farsi language, the Arabic language, so that people could read Baha'i texts in their original format. She absolutely loved the people there. And sometimes they would take her out to do up to 40 speaking sessions a day. So very, very tiring. Not unlike Abdul Baha's own schedule when he was traveling himself. So very, very interesting for her to go there. She was still anxious to get to the Holy Land. It was still not possible. She felt very responsible for her parents, who were back, you know, elderly now, you know, back in Ohio. But she cabled them, and they were still okay. So she decided to continue her journey. So she heads on to Japan. And this is a photograph of Martha in Japan. This is Agnes Alexander, another young American Baha'i who was actually living in Japan at the time. And this young man, I've forgotten his name, but he was the first Japanese Baha'i. So again, because Agnes Alexander was there, she was now able to organize places for Martha to go and talk and present her, you know, her delivery of this, the Baha'i Faith, the work for peace, work for unity, and all of that. Oh, Mr. Fukuta, his name is. I've just seen it. Because Martha was a Baha'i, it just opened doors to her. And actually, I did have the slide in of the premier of Japan, Premier Okuma. He looked very scary in the picture. And look him up on YouTube. And she managed an interview with him. So this was very interesting. She was then able to send an article home back to America saying that she'd interviewed the Premier of Japan. She was also there for the coronation of the Emperor Yoshihito and the Empress Sadako. This was a complete fashion scoop for Martha. And again, that went down very well with the newspapers back home. So on So this was her first journey. She then heads from Japan to Hawaii, and by the 29th of August 1915, she's now back in America. Okay, so when she gets back to America, Martha is now, she's had sort of a fact-finding tour and all the rest of it. She then does a lot of work with the Baha'is in America. I'm not even going to touch upon this at all. If I do that, we'll have to have about 10 sessions. So she was in America for 4 years. She worked, you know, phenomenal work that she did there. But basically, she just couldn't wait to get on the road again. You know, she had itchy feet, and Abdul Baha wanted her to go down to South America. So that's where she was heading for. Sorry, November 1919 it was, 4 years since her first trip. She felt she had to go to South America. Now Martha, she traveled with 17 pieces of luggage. This was not about her, I have to say. Martha dressed completely simply. She was not bothered about her appearance, but she was very practical. She had her typewriter with her. Typewriters were enormous in those days. It was way before having a little MacBook Air or, you know, whatever we have now. She carried that with her. And also the other skill that Martha had was working with the Baha'is back in America to get literature on the Baha'i Faith published, because there was nothing. Very little had been translated into other languages. And so she carried with her books. With Roy Wilhelm, who was the first Baha'i that she met, they had been working on booklets. They produced two little booklets called Big Ben and Little Ben. They were blue booklets, and they just were kind of a synopsis of the Baha'i Faith, of its teachings. And she carried literally thousands of those with her. She knew that she would be able to earn her living now, because wherever she went to, she would be able to do her Baha'i work, and equally she would be able to send articles back to the Pittsburgh Dispatch. Or in fact, she contacted a syndicate of newspapers from America who were all keen on getting her stories. So there was a month's delay when she arrived at the port, because of the striking seamen. Now Martha, not to miss an opportunity, she actually went and gave a talk to the seamen on the spiritual solutions for the economic problems in the world, and they received her very favorably, apparently. And anyway, soon she was on the ship setting sail for South America. The ship was called the Alba. Now, I guess it was a cruise ship, I'm imagining. And it was basically the people that were on board, they were pretty wealthy. Martha was just going on the journey. She needed to get to South America, and that was the only way to get there. The people there were there to have a really good time. They would be smoking, gambling, drinking, and all the rest of it. Now, Abdul Baha had advised Martha not to seem cold and unsympathetic when meeting strangers. Help to make them feel at home. Ask if you may render any service to make their lives a little happier. Let those who meet you know, without your proclaiming the fact, that you are a Baha'i. And in fact, Martha again had a great time on board. She was really popular. Let me just read a little bit from the book here, because it's quite interesting. Yeah, the drinking on the ship was great and constant. The bar, which was next to Martha's room, was open from 6 a.m. to 2 a.m. in order to be accommodating to as many drinkers as possible. Martha's roommate was a champion poker player and stayed up half the night proving it. She also owned two monkeys which shared the cabin. So basically, Martha was in a cabin, her roommate was up half the night playing poker, and she'd got two monkeys in the cabin. But so in the midst of, you know, this sophisticated, high living crowd, Martha was the most popular and surely the most unique woman on board. she shared in the gala festivities. As a fancy dress, she went as a Persian woman, and she was chosen by the captain to present the prizes. So basically, she just joined in with everybody, and the captain suggested that she gave a talk on the Baha'i faith to all the passengers, which she did. The chief steward also suggested that Martha spoke to the Chinese seamen on board and gave them the Baha'i message. So there was a lot of interest in those days. So as they stopped off on their way around, now I don't know if I can just minimize that for a moment. The ship was stopping, if I can see it with my really bad eyesight, Belen and Fortaleza. It was stopping in both of these places. Now, most of the passengers on board, they'd get off and explore whatever they wanted to do. But Martha was just really keen to, wherever she landed, she wanted to know the population and she wanted to know the number of newspapers in the area. And so when she landed, she would do everything that she could to contact the newspapers. Now, she didn't have the language. She didn't know Portuguese. And in Belém, she landed. She went into the newspaper offices. She tried to explain that she was a Baha'i, that she had articles that she could give to them. And they were having real difficulty translating. But in walks an attorney who speaks fluent English. And he tells Martha that if she produces an article of 1,000 words, he will translate it and get it published. So this is what Martha did. She would, wherever she landed, she would get articles published in the newspapers. She would put books into libraries. And if she was there for long enough, she would give talks to various groups. Goodness knows how she did it, because she didn't even know anybody whenever she landed. When they then go on to Recife, she also lands in Fortaleza. In Recife, they now find out that in Bahia, where she's heading for, yellow fever is raging, and they've also got a few cases in Recife. So most people on the boat do not land, and in fact, they're told that if they do land, they will not be taken back on board because of yellow fever. So Martha takes a chance and she lands there, and she just thinks that she's going to have to try to get a boat down, you know, down to Bahia and Rio de Janeiro later. So basically, she lands in Fortaleza. She still hasn't got any Portuguese. She goes to a hotel and she finds an American woman staying there. It turns out that this lady is called Lillian Vega, and she knows Lua Getzinger, who we saw in the slides earlier on. She then takes Martha route around all the local newspapers, the dailies and everything, and Martha gets articles published in all the newspapers in that area. Basically, wherever Martha landed, people would be attracted to her. She didn't know the language, she was alone, but people somehow came up to her and she was undaunted. She didn't let the fact that she didn't know the language put her off from sharing this message that she had for people. And it's worth noting that Martha, like Abdu'l-Bahá, they were traveling with a message of universal peace and unity. They weren't necessarily going around the world trying to make Baha'i converts. Many people did become Baha'i, obviously, but that wasn't their aim. It was to share this new message and these new teachings. So she then travels on. She goes on a boat, the Itapuí, for Bahia, and they arrive there in the midst of violent storms. By the way, Martha hated traveling on the seas. It was the only form of transport. And she, again, like Abdu'l-Bahá, she traveled very simply, always in third class. and these stormy seas. She was always seasick and it was just ghastly most of the time. Now, when she gets down to Rio de Janeiro, she knows that she's going to be going down to Argentina later. So she organises, she cables back to America that she needs 5,000 booklets produced in Spanish that she will need in Buenos Aires. So Martha was always ahead of the game. She was always writing. She was always preparing to get booklets or the literature that she needed for all the places that she was going to. And it was not easy, not in 1919. So by the 5th of September, she went on to Sao Paulo. She found this paradisical, really. Many of the places she went to, it was so cold and she didn't like the cold. But here it was lovely paradise, forests and trees. And she was, again, on board, she would give the Baha'i message. She then gets down to Montevideo. She travels down to there on yet another boat. Now, interestingly, do you remember the roommate that she had back on the first boat coming out from San Francisco, the poker-playing lady who would play poker all night and who had two monkeys? Well, she lived in Montevideo. So Martha only had a 12-hour stop there. So she made contact with this lady and she ended up helping her to put books in the library and to contact the newspaper editors in Montevideo. So basically with Martha, anybody who she met would help her on this journey. So she gave many talks in all of these places. She now travels down to Buenos Aires and spends some time there. The booklets in Spanish will have arrived. She contacts the newspapers again and gives talks to. She would give talks to anybody and everybody. I'll go into that a little bit more next week. But she would, the theosophists were one group who always welcomed a Baha'i talk. Any groups, anyone at all. The Esperantists she would give talks to, the universities, schools, colleges, they all seem to welcome her with open arms. Okay, so now Martha's difficulty now is she's got to get from Buenos Aires over the Andes Mountains into Chile, because she has promised Abdu'l-Bahá that she will go up the west coast of South America up to Panama. So this is her goal. Now, this was a complete adventure story. So I have to read this from the book because it's just an unbelievable story. She, you know, in those days, it was the days before Cotswold shops or, you know, Mountain Warehouse where we can get all our waterproofs and everything. There was simply nothing like that. And Martha just describes having on three sweaters, two woolen coats, a hat, and she was still freezing. So the trip would begin by train and then shift to muleback. Martha was fortunate in having a young Italian woman as a roommate from Buenos Aires, they began the journey by train. Now, a landslide had washed out the route that Martha was to have driven, so other means of transport were found. So the same Martha Root, who was setting a speed record through the French villages in Mr. Berg's automobile 17 years earlier, she now climbed on a mule to cross the snow-capped Andes. She recorded the experience in her diary. The trip by mule back over the top of the world for the Andes are amongst the highest ranges. The ancient trail led 10,400 feet above sea level. The people on mule were like infinitesimal specks clinging to mighty terraces. As ants and in an endless and boundless forest, so we huddled on the edge of jagged peaks, frozen chasms and stiffened mountain torrents. Fortunately, the sun shone brightly. There was a wonderful feeling of camaraderie. Martha was part of a little tour of people who were doing the same thing, trying to get to Chile. A detour through one dark mountain took over an hour in stumbling, slipping blackness in which the frightened mules shied and fell. Martha, as her mule plunged downward into the mouth of the tunnel, gripped the pommel, terrified. Later, out from the tunnel, when the procession came to a precipitous downward slope towards Chile, Martha could not even see 1 inch in front of her. Such was the mist that had fallen. To her, this was by far the most dangerous part of the journey. Now everyone got off their mules and began walking farther in on the mountainside. Sometimes the mules would slip a yard in this perpendicular path. They were frightened also. Taking the guide's hand, they made the descent together. The warm sun had melted the crisp snow just enough and they could get a foothold. They stopped every few minutes to breathe, as one's breath is very short in this altitude. Some fainted, some had puna, which is breathing of the nose and ears. The descent was finally complete, and the other side of the Andes was a victorious reality. So let's just look. Martha managed to make the journey up through the west of South America, and she got to Panama, to the Baha'i House of Worship there. And in fact, this building wasn't there, but when Martha was there, she predicted that one day there would be a university, a place of learning for the Baha'is in the future. So that was that. And her last journey, which was to Central America, Mexico and Guatemala. So this is Martha's third journey, basically from South America. She went back to the United States after Panama. She also tried to land on a leper colony in Panama, but was unable to do so because of the sea conditions. She was soon back in Florida. And again, she did much on the home front, not least the first Race Amity Conference on the 19th of May, 1921. That's worth mentioning that. And that included Lewis Gregory, who Terence spoke about. Now, from this time onwards, Martha is 49 years old. The breast cancer, which we mentioned at the beginning, had somehow been in remission all this time. But for many years now, she was in great pain. She'd got pain in her chest and in her stomach. She was also worried about her father's health, which was deteriorating. But slowly his health improved, as did Martha's. So she was ready to go again. And she wanted to, so she headed down from America to Mexico. Her goal was Mexico and Guatemala, and this story won't take too long. What was funny about the story, though, was when she headed down to Texas in Austin, and basically, never to miss an opportunity on her way down. Again, I'm going to read from the book because it's just much more fun. I should just mention on the way down, she visited Eugene Debs at the federal prison. He was an activist for the rights of laborers, and Martha supported him very much. And in fact, her letters helped to get him released from prison. And Mr. Debs remained a friend of the Baha'is right throughout his life. And I love the way that these early Baha'is in the 1900s, they just worked with anybody and everybody, as we try to now, who are working for peace and justice. We're all part of the same process, and that was interesting. The other funny thing was, in Texas, Martha decided there was a group of 25 miles from Austin in the Texas mountains, where her companion, Anna Reinker, was raised. There, at a Saturday night dance, the cowboys were told about the Baha'i Faith, So she just couldn't resist, you know, a group of cowboys, you know, they certainly needed to know about it. So she reports, at 10:30, after the Texas jigs, everybody sat down and Miss Root, she always referred to herself in the third person, she never said I, gave the history of the Baha'i cause and all the vital principles. Miss Reinker passed around the blue booklets. The cowboys were interested and showed their appreciation. Martha felt that those cowboys would be fearless in proclaiming the message of world peace, since in that region, they were undoubtedly courageous through their life on the rough Western trails. So that was just an interesting aside. So just to finish off then, Martha makes her way down to Mexico. Now, as Bernie said, I spent a bit of time as a Baha'i in Mexico and Belize. But unlike Martha, well, like Martha, she arrived not knowing the soul. I was the same, but I met up with some Baha'is pretty quickly. There were no Baha'is in Mexico when Martha was there. So she didn't know a soul. And she just decided, again, she was a journalist. Her first call was made to President Álvaro Obregón. She just walked straight in. More than 100 soldiers stood around the palace office building, which extended the entire length of the cathedral plaza. She explained that she was bringing the President of the Republic of Mexico, Baha'u'llah's solution of the economic problem. She showed several introductory letters of recommendation. Now, she never gets turned away. This is the funny thing about Martha. The soldiers ushered her from one official to another until she reached the private secretary of the president. He spoke English perfectly. She explained and gave through him to the president Baha'u'llah's economic solution. So that was quite interesting. So she didn't actually get to see the president, but it would all have been passed on to him. So during the 3 weeks in Mexico, Martha contacted editors of magazines, newspapers, spoke in churches, both Catholic and Protestant. She was the house guest at a congressman's wife in Puebla. So all of this from knowing nobody, from knowing not a soul, all of these things happened. And then the final thing that happened was she went down to Guatemala. Now, I've been to Guatemala. When I was there in the 70s, there was a lot of political unrest right through Central America. And it was no different when Martha was there. In fact, everybody, her friends back in America, begged her not to go. It was just far too dangerous. But she boarded a train. She was told that nobody would be on this train, but there were. She made friends with a German woman whose son met them at the border. And because of the son's friendship with the Central American consul, he managed to validate Martha's passport, which saved her from staying for 4 days to get her passport validated. So basically then, she got into Guatemala. Her first sortie was to arrange an interview with the President of the Republic, Carlos Herrera. She spoke with the secretary of the minister, explained the Baha'i teachings, and left several Baha'i booklets. Now, this time she secured an interview with the president. So that was quite a coup. An interview with the president was arranged for Monday or Tuesday at 2:30 p.m. Always mañana, mañana, but nonetheless, she'd got an interview. So she appeared on the Monday, but Martha was asked to come back on the Tuesday. Now, such was the political situation. By Tuesday, President Herrera was ex-President Herrera. He'd been deposed overnight. And this was the revolution. Machine guns were in action all over the city all night. The place was surrounded by 500 soldiers. President Herrera was kept a prisoner there, and his cabinet were imprisoned in the fortress. But the Baha'i message had been given to the liberals, some of the very men who the next day went into the office under the new government. So that was Martha's time there. When she looked back, this was actually in November 1921, and she was very scared, you have to say. You know, she was only human. She was scared. But she prayed to Abdul Baha, and significantly, the very night when all of this happened was the night when Abdu'l-Bahá passed away in Haifa. Martha didn't know that at the time, of course, but she, you know, she felt this was very significant, you know, that happened on that night. I'm going to stop there. I'm so sorry. I've gone way over. And, you know, you can see next week when we start the rest of her journey, Martha is approaching 50 years old. So any of you out there who think your life is over at 50, think again. So next week we'll be looking at her visits, her several visits to Queen Marie of Romania, King Zog of Albania, presidents, so much more than this week. So I'm going to have a job to get it in one session again. But thank you very much for listening.